Hey everybody, welcome back to A Better Computer. My name is Matt, and I recently said this on an episode of my podcast, Comfort Zone.
So I am bringing an app that I would say is the most transformative app I've used personally, maybe in years.
Wow.
It's astonishingly good.
Now that's a big statement, I know, but I really do think that Cursor is the most transformative product I've used in a while. I think it is an absolutely fantastic tool for someone exactly like me who is an amateur developer, who knows enough code to be dangerous but needs help consistently and doesn't know how to do everything off the top of their head and just needs help getting over the hump sometimes of some programming challenges. I don't think it totally replaces the need to understand how products work and how code works, but it's a really great assistant, and I've used a couple of these coding assistants in the past, and Cursor is the one that's really just, I don't know exactly why, but it's really been the most reliable for me and the most helpful in my experience. So today I'm going to walk you through a real life example of how I can use Cursor to build a very simple analytics dashboard for usage of my new app that I just released called Quick Reviews. I did make a video this week about it. It just came out this week. If you want to check it out, I think you might enjoy it. But I want to show you today how I'm going to use an analytics file that I have from that project to build myself a dashboard and monitor how the app is performing. And I'm going to use Cursor to help me write it in no time. All right, so here we are on the Mac, and I'm looking at Xcode just to start. I want to show you the log, basically the analytics log that's happening here. It's not super interesting. There's no personal information here. It's very simple. But basically, I'm logging the media type. Are you doing a movie, TV show, book, game, or music? What device type, iPhone or iPad? Are you a premium subscriber or not? What action are you performing? Again, no information on what the details of that action are, but like, are you saving a review? Are you deleting your history? That sort of thing. And then accent color, I'm logging what accent color you're using in the app. Are you using the default pink or have you switched to something else? I'm just curious. And basically what this is doing is it's hitting an analytics endpoint I've created on my server. And that endpoint is processing the request, and then it's generating the CSV. It's basically just adding a new row to the CSV every time it's hit. And I took a snapshot of that CSV here so we could work with it locally. But basically, here's all the data, and you can see it's very anonymous. There's no personal information here. I just can see mostly people are reviewing movies. Some people are doing TV shows is probably second most. And then games, books, and music are a far third place. But yeah, so here's the logs. Not super easy to parse and understand, but I want to make a dashboard of this. I want to see some basic information, and this is where Cursor can come in. So I'm going to open this over here, and this is the interface for using Cursor. You can chat, so you can just chat with Cursor and just get it'll look at your code and help you with things. But Composer is where you go to help you actually write the code. So the first thing you need to know is context. Cursor can view your entire project that you're looking at, so it can find everything, but it's easier if you start with giving it the context of a specific file, right? And so I have the iOS logs file open here, and when I open the Composer with this file selected, it automatically adds that. You can also drag things in. So if I wanted to drag in this animation file and collapse it, I could make sure that's included as well. I don't think I need that, so we're just going to leave that blank. And you can also choose your model from here. So I have found Claude 3.5 Sonnet to be the best coding companion. GPT is pretty okay. O1 is maybe better. O3 Mini has been added. So I should maybe try those as well. But we're going to go with Claude just because I know it works well. I've had plenty of experience with it and it's very, very solid. So let's go ahead and ask for some sort of dashboard. And this is really handing off all the code to Cursor. So I'm going to write it out right now, and then I'll kind of explain to you what I'm doing while it's working. All right, so I've written out some pretty lengthy requirements here, and I currently have slow mode enabled, but it's going to get going actually right away. So while it's working, I'm going to explain to you what I asked for. So basically I said I want to create a dashboard page in this project that's a simple HTML file with CSS and JavaScript that looks at this iOS log CSV file and parses the data into quickly glanceable metrics. And then here's what I'm interested in. How many reviews have been posted in the past 7 days, and how does that compare to the 7 days before that? So I want to know, in the last 7 days, how many reviews have been created, and how does that compare to the 7 days before that? Just, is it going up or down? How many users have exported their data, and what is the average number of records in that export? Are people exporting their data? And if so, how large is this export? How many things are people exporting from the app? How many reviews are being created per day in the form of a bar chart? So now I get into charts. So how many reviews are being created in the form of a bar chart? I just want a bar chart showing how many reviews people are making. What accent colors are people using in the form of a pie chart? And I want all the slices to match the colors the user would have chosen. So if they're using pink as their accent color, I want the pie slice to be pink. If it's purple, make it purple, blue, you know, you get it. What proportion of users are on the iPhone versus iPad in a pie chart, media type in a pie chart, and is user subscribed in the form of a pie chart? And so it gets going, and it kind of talks you through everything it does. You may have noticed some files have been created up here. We'll get to those in a second. So I'll help you create a dashboard to visualize this data. We'll use Chart.js for its visualization since it's easy to use and looks great. Let's create the necessary files. So it starts by creating dashboard.html. So that makes sense. I can see it over here, dashboard.html. And here's a preview of the file. We'll get into more details in a second. It created a special CSS file for that. If I didn't want it to do that, I could specify add the stuff to the normal CSS file, but we're fine with this for now. And it created its own JavaScript for it as well. So it does all the coding for you, and then it explains what it did. This creates a responsive dashboard that shows all the metrics you requested. To use it, create these three files in the same directory, which it has. Make sure the iOS log CSV file is also in that directory. It is. And serve the files through a web server. You can't load CSV files directly from the file system due to browser security restrictions. Great. So we'll have to load this on my web server to see it in action. The dashboard features a clean blah, blah, blah. So it's kind of explains things. And then I can just accept everything right away. I can just say accept all. But let's review the changes. I really like this bit. So now what it's going to do is it's going to think for a second, and it's going to take me through all the code changes. Now, this is all net new code. If it was doing diffs, this would be look a little different. Same idea, though. And basically, it takes me through everything. So this is a dashboard HTML structure and layout with placeholders for metrics and charts. So this is the HTML file that we're going to go to. Here's all the code for it. And cool, I can accept that. Here's the CSS. Again, I can look at it, I can review it, I can accept it. I should also say this is a very large request. Usually my requests are a lot smaller, so it's a lot less to review. But yeah, here's all of the code it wrote. So it wrote a significant amount of code here for us, and we've accepted all three of them. And the issue we're going to run into is if I try to load this, we're going to reload the page, and we don't want to go to index, we want to go to dashboard.html. Here's the dashboard, but yeah, it's not loading anything. So let's go ahead and inspect. And if we go to the console, yeah, accessed file is blocked by Core's policy. So let's throw this on my web server and try this again. Okay, so I have tossed them on my web server, and let's go to quickreviews.app and let's go to /dashboard.html. And hopefully this will load. It does. Great. So analytics dashboard. So we have review activity in the last 7 days, zero reviews versus the last seven, zero. So it doesn't see anything there. Exports, four exports with an average of 30 records. Daily reviews, you can see this is me kind of doing testing in dev, and then it released on the second and really got going on the third. And so there's the reviews we have each of those days. Accent color, this is actually only in my development branch right now, so this sliver is my usage on the dev version of the app. Everyone in production is not reporting this yet, so this will fill up sooner or later, I should say. iPhone versus iPad, we can see mostly iPhone users are using this. Media types, as we saw when we just kind of glanced at the logs, movies are dominating. And yeah, there's the other things. And free versus premium, we see there are far fewer premium users. Most people don't subscribe. I think like 12% of people have converted to premium so far. But the people who do are using it notably more. So interesting data there. This is interesting. This is actually wrong. So let's see what we can do. So this is where you kind of get into your conversation with the chatbot. So this is kind of what ends up happening for a lot of this stuff is this mostly worked, right? Like you may, I have qualms with how this looks specifically. Like I'd like to update this and make it look better, but it, generally this works. This is functional. And so let's see what it's doing here. So it didn't quite get there, like I said, so this was wrong. So looking at the code, I see the issue. In the calculate review stats, we're using the most recent timestamp, but we should use the actual dates to ensure we're counting reviews within the correct time periods. So here we go. It's explaining the changes again. We're going to hit return to see the differences one at a time. And now we can see more of a diff. So it's updated calculate reviews to change the math, and it's added comments as well in the code to explain kind of what it's doing. Again, we're just going to kind of go with this. I'm going to review these. I'm going pretty quickly now, but if this was for real, I would look at these a little more closely. But I can kind of see these and be like, okay, that looks pretty decent. I do, since I'm developing locally, I need to move these to my server again. So 1 second. Okay, and if I reload the page, it's still zero. Why is it still zero? Okay, so it's still showing zero. What's wrong? Here's an interesting thing. I have found sometimes when I ask it to do something, it's going to get close but not be totally perfect. And what I may want to do is actually just start over. So let me restore from where I started. It's going to retain this chat thing. I'm not going to change a single word. I'm just going to ask it to do it again. And what we'll find here is that it's going to do it slightly differently. It might turn out something that's very, very similar, but remember how this looks. It may not look like this again. And in actual fact, I have done this already, and this looks very different from what it generated the first time. This is actually much worse than what it generated the first time. So let's give it another shot at it. Let's see if it gets it right this time. It does the math correctly. It makes the UI look nice. Let's just see what happens and see if it improves or not. So we'll give it a second to finish. I'll move the files to my server so that we can actually access the CSV, and then we'll see how it went. Okay, so it has done it again. I've moved the files to my server, and you might have noticed it actually only created a dashboard HTML and dashboard JS. So I'm guessing it did inline CSS. Where's the CSS for this? I don't know. We'll see. So I have moved them onto my server. It's the same file name. Let's go ahead and reload. It looks totally different, right? So similar, right? It's using the same JavaScript library, but it has done it differently. So 636 reviews in the last 7 days, and that's up 1,000% from the previous seven. That makes sense. That was just me versus now everybody, or me and beta testers versus everybody. 9 exports have happened, and then an average of 64. So those numbers are different. So I would want to validate that, right? I need to go to the CSV file. I should check these to make sure that they're correct. I should check the JavaScript to make sure it's counting correctly. But we're on the right track, right? And so we're in a pretty good place. You can see this is a difference as well. It is not reporting the unknown accent colors like the other one was, so it's omitting those. So again, the logic is slightly different. It is changing things, right? And so from here, I could just kind of keep using this as a normal code editor. I could close this and start updating the code myself if I wanted to tweak things, if I wanted to just make changes for styling or whatever. I can just do that manually now. I don't have to keep using the AI assistant, right? I can, but I don't have to. This is a Visual Studio Code fork, so all the VS Code extensions and color themes and stuff work great with it. It's really, really nice. And yeah, if you like VS Code, this is great as well. And then you can just, boop, enable this, and now you have a really competent AI assistant. I will say I have used GitHub Copilot, which has a free option where you can get a good number of requests. I think it's like 50 requests or something for free every month, and that will work in VS Code. I do not find GitHub Copilot to be as good an interface. I don't find it describes what it's doing as well. It doesn't have as good an interface for updating your files. It's just not as good in my opinion, but it is free, and that's definitely appealing. Cursor is not free. I probably should mention the pricing here. If I go to my browser and go to Cursor, if we go to pricing, pricing, if you pay monthly, is $20 per month. It drops down to $16 per month, which if we do 16 times 12, that's $192. Again, I really hate when they don't say the amount you're about to be charged on their monthly plans. I get why they don't, but yeah. I'm currently paying for the monthly one because I don't think I'll need it all the time, but when I do want to make these big changes and I want it to really help me go quick, $20 a month is totally worth it for me for the amount of time and stuff that it saves me. So, but yeah, that is Cursor. it really has been helpful for me in learning how to get into iOS development and really holding my hand in my code project, in my project that I'm working on, and not just giving me generic answers. I have to figure out how to map to my system. It just works really, really well. And yeah, I'm a big fan of it. So that's it for today. Thank you so much for watching. Bye-bye.